I understand that the networks for storage space started to destroy a lot of those things. Did you lose any of your rare?
Yes, as a matter of fact, the only network I know that made this error, although others might have without it coming to my attention, was NBC. Some one dumb fellow had burned everything that NBC had. Their giant primetime shows, their newscast. Can you imagine burning newscasts? I mean, this is American history.
Hi, I'm Rob Word. Welcome to Wednesday. And we're going to go way back today because it's our new series, Way Back on Wednesday. Wow! And we've got a genius today, going way back to the mid-70s when I interviewed Steve Allen, the father of late-night comedy television. He was the host of The Tonight Show, the very first host, and he had an array of great sidekicks with Don Knotts, Tom Poston, Steve and Edie Gourmet. And then he went into primetime opposite Ed Sullivan. We're going to talk all about that. And I did get some comments about my bow tie in the last interviews that we used from Stardom, this series from the 70s. So I thought I'd wear a bow tie today in honor of Steve Allen. The problem was I had forgotten how to tie it, and I spent about 15 minutes laughing. My arms got sore, but here it is. What do you think? It's a little smaller than the ones in the show, but we're going to get right to the show. These were 5 2.5-minute segments called Stardom. And Steve Allen, we appreciate you being there. We're going to find out why he was so very mad at NBC losing those shows from The Tonight Show. Let's get to it. I'll see you at the end of the show.
Our guest on Stardom today is the man who created the talk show format for television, Mr. Steve Allen. Welcome to Stardom, Steve.
Thank you, Rob. It's nice to be here.
You began on radio, didn't you?
Well, I began in kindergarten, actually. But yes, I worked in radio before I worked in television, simply because they invented radio first. If they'd invented television first, I would have been glad to do it the other way around.
But on KNX in Los Angeles is when you had your late-night talk show.
Well, before that particular program, I had done a comedy series, 5 days a week, on the Mutual Radio Network in 1946 and 47. So I never really made my living as, quote, a disc jockey. I was working as a comedian before I got into that. But my first work in radio was as an announcer and writer and producer and pianist and singer at the CBS outlet in Phoenix, Arizona, KOY.
When you moved to Los Angeles, how did you evolve into the talk show format that has become regarded as the standard on television today?
Well, following the that two-year show I mentioned on Mutual, I was suddenly out of work. So the local KNX CBS station there had a half hour open late at night. And what they had in mind was that I would spin records and perhaps say something witty after each record. So as soon as it became apparent to me that the guys weren't listening to me who had hired me anyway because I was on late at night, I began to play less and less records and do more and more talking. And that immediately became successful, because there were about 10 other guys playing records on the air at the same time, and one man can play a record as well as another. So that was the start of it. Gradually we began adding a studio audience, and then we had to get to a larger studio, and finally we had about 1,000 people a night in their large theater there. And we had given up the records fairly early in the game, and we're just interviewing people, going through the studio audience, and interviewing famous guests. And that's really where the genesis of what eventually became The Tonight Show was. I modified it a bit when I went into television later.
How did you make your big move to New York?
Oh, I just got in an old blue Buick and took off on Route 66, I guess. But all seriousness aside, I was working, as we've mentioned earlier, for CBS in radio in Los Angeles. And about 1950, television itself was just getting started. So because of the success of my radio shows in the Western market, they thought I should come to New York, because in those days, if you were on network, you had to do it from New York. They didn't really have a coast-to-coast cable at that time. So I went to New York and worked for 3 years on various television assignments for CBS.
Were they doing kinescopes at that time?
Well, now everything was live, but of course, for legal purposes, they would occasionally make a kinescope film. And if your show was to be seen in another part of the country to which the cable didn't reach, then they would make a 16 millimeter black and white film called a kinescope film and mail that out. So there was no way in those days to be live all over the whole country.
Well, when those kinescopes were being made, a lot of the live guests that you were having, a lot of the ad-lib things that were going on would have been lost forever if it hadn't been for those kinescopes. But I understand that the networks for storage space started to destroy a lot of those things. Did you lose any of your rare shows?
Yes. As a matter of fact, the only network I know that made this error, although others might have without it coming to my attention, was NBC. And I found this out when I wrote to them and asked if I could see whatever they had about on my old Tonight Show, which I did for 3 years, the original Tonight Show. And it turned out that they had destroyed not only that, which was not too pleasant news, but even worse in terms of historical documentation, they had, not they, some one dumb fellow, had burned everything that NBC had. Their giant primetime shows, their newscast. Can you imagine burning newscasts? I mean, this is American history. But this knucklehead had burned it all. And he'd probably still be doing it if somebody didn't find out what he was doing and, you know, they laid hands on him and stopped him. He's probably running the network today.
Why do you think people thought so little of television as to just destroy the history that was already broadcast?
I don't think this man thought at all of television. He was only concerned about keeping costs down in his department. And his department was to store things. He was, frankly, I was joking before, he's not a network executive. He was a man who was in charge of shelving, and it didn't matter to him whether he was storing cans of film or you know, old microphones or what it might be. So when he saw that he was running out of shelf space, he solved the problem, in quotes, by burning all the old stuff so he'd have shelf space for the new stuff.
Moving from The Tonight Show, a late-night program on NBC that was formulated by Steve Allen, he took a lot of the people he had worked with late night on NBC to Sunday nights opposite CBS's King of Sunday Night, Ed Sullivan. In that first year in 1956, Steve Allen brought his wit, his music, and his whole crew from The Tonight Show over to NBC. What was it like going up against what you knew would be tough competition on CBS?
Oddly enough, we never really thought of that. The network thought a lot about it because, as you know, networks are not really in the entertainment business, they're in the ratings business. I don't mean that as a joke, I mean it simply as a statement of fact. And the reason that they, as executives of program departments, have to be in the ratings business is that if they don't produce high ratings, they get fired. It's quite simple. And nobody ever keeps them on the job just because their programs are good. The people who sell the advertising time don't care whether the programs are good or bad. It's nice if they are, but the only thing that matters is ratings. So they cared, as I say, a lot about that, and I didn't give a darn about it, to tell you the truth. I was very interested in doing a good show, and Ed was, of course, a newspaper man. He was in no sense an entertainer, and therefore there was no difficulty in doing a better show than Ed. But I told the network from the first they would be very unrealistic if they thought that we would very often get higher ratings, and I was therefore amazed that quite often we did. About every, I don't know, 5 or 6 weeks, we would get the higher rating. And usually, talent had nothing whatever to do with it. For example, we beat Sullivan in our very second week on the air opposite him simply by booking Elvis Presley. And that had nothing to do with Elvis's talent since it hadn't been displayed really at that time. The average person didn't know about it. But a lot of controversy had grown up around his style of singing. So we got an enormous rating that night just by that means.
Since you did run Elvis before CBS did, and they did crop him from the navel up, did you have a full shot of him? I know that you had him singing to a stuffed dog, I believe, singing Hound Dog.
No, it was an actual Hound Dog we had him singing to. That was my idea. As I said, there was so much criticism and controversy. Now you can act like that and become a priest, you know, but 20 years ago people thought that that was a big deal. So I had the idea of putting him in white tie and tails, and we had a very dignified set with Grecian columns and clouds and that sort of thing. Very classy. It looked like a set for Charles Laughton to read Shakespeare, you know. And we were the ones who, as I say, who photographed him from the waist up, partly as a joke and partly to just shut up people who thought that men should not move when they sing. So that's how that happened. And ours was a comedy show. Ed's was a variety show. So practically everything we did had a comedy context to it.
The Benny Goodman story. Steve Allen starring as the great clarinetist Benny Goodman. I saw Benny Goodman on Merv Griffin the other day, and Merv brought up the movie, and suddenly Benny Goodman started laughing uncontrollably, and he didn't stop. Why was that? Was the film not very accurate?
Well, if you stop to think that it takes, let's say, 57 years for a man to live his life, or whatever number of years, and the movie only runs about an hour and 10 minutes, obviously you're going to leave out a lot, you know, like 56 years of it you're leaving out. I wasn't terribly happy with the script myself, although the picture turned out to be enormously successful at the box office, which was all the studio cared about. And it was great to hear those wonderful old Goodman arrangements played by all, you know, Benny Goodman musicians, including Benny himself. I was just pretending to play. But there was a lot of Benny's life that was left out, and they just gave a kind of a very unrealistic, digested version of it. So both Benny and I were a little unhappy with the script, but the picture was a hit anyway. I guess it didn't matter.
In Martin Scorsese's New York, New York, Robert De Niro learned to mimic a saxophone player.
Well, I'm not sure how he learned to mimic, but I had to learn how to play the clarinet because while I could, you know, blow at the right time and move my fingers like that, there are millions of clarinet players in the world, all of whom would have been aware that my fingers were on the wrong holes. So I had to simply learn to play the clarinet, and I can still play it to this day as a result of that, although not terribly well. There's one scene in the picture where you do hear me playing and not Benny, but I'm not on the screen at the time. That's the scene where Benny is 9 years old and is learning to play his first scales. So Benny literally could not make the sound of a beginner because of his developed embouchure, but that was the only sound I could make at that stage. So where you hear Benny playing the scales, you're actually hearing me.
Another film that you did I thought was an exceptional movie. You had a small part in it. Was Carl Reiner's The Comic with Dick Van Dyke.
Yes, it was an interesting film. I just played a little walk-on part of a talk show host one day.
Why do you think that film failed at commercially at the box office?
I don't know. It's very difficult to explain why a good many artistic productions fail, and perhaps sometimes even more difficult to explain why others succeed. Occasionally, there is a relationship between excellence and success, but frequently, there is no such relationship, and therefore, you're left with a very mysterious question. As a class, I think we Americans are not terribly interested in talent. We have nothing against it. It's better to hear a man play the trombone wonderfully than terribly. We can understand that. But there are hundreds and thousands of very talented people around the country at this moment who are probably playing to very small audiences if they're working at all. But once you're successful, that is very impressive to people. They get very excited if they meet you, if you've just had a hit record or a hit movie or something. So it's your success they're responding to and not your talent. On a more rational planet, that would not be the case.
Meaning of the Minds, an innovative talk show from the man who created talk shows, Mr. Steve Allen, our guest today on Stardom. Meeting of the Minds, you're talking with people who were instrumental in the development of the world but who are no longer with us. How did you devise that idea?
I don't really know how anyone gets any creative idea. That's always a mysterious process, but you've described it quite well. Just one more talk show. But I think 100 years from now, people will remember this one, whereas all the other talk shows we've done, who cares? It's like a paper blowing away down the alley. But this one is important because the guests are important. They are the great personages of history. We have them on four at a time. They're people who could not have met in reality. For example, on our pilot show, we had Thomas Aquinas, Theodore Roosevelt, Queen Cleopatra of Egypt, and Thomas Paine of the American and French Revolutions. It's not a comedy series, I should explain, and they appear just as they would in reality, and they engage in very heated debate, and it's quite exciting. And we have a great many important people, Martin Luther, Thomas More, Karl Marx, Voltaire, Susan B. Anthony, Florence Nightingale, the Dowager Empress of China, all great people.
Your Steve Allen's Laugh Back, I thought, was of all of the programs that were brought back and trying to recycle them, Show of Shows, the Ernie Kovacs thing, I thought yours was the best because of the way you interspersed the old kinescopes with the new stuff, and a rare example of the new stuff being just as brilliant as the old thing.
Ah, thank you. Yes, we did 23 90-minute specials in that form, and we'd still be on the air doing more. But for a rather unusual turn of events, our union, AFTRA, put the show off the air. They had been trying to all along. They argued that we had no right to show old film, or old videotape, as the case may be. It was never clear as to on what principle they based their position. But to make a long story short, they controlled us, and they finally put us off the air. But those 23 90-minute shows are still around, and they can be seen for all eternity, I suppose.
In a couple of different markets, was the title different on it? Steve Allen's Left Back in some places and billed as something else on other stations?
I've heard of that, but I've never understood those reports. All I ever heard about was Steve Allen's Left Back. Somebody told me in Seattle or something it was running as the best of Steve Allen.
Right.
But if anyone knows anything about that, I'd appreciate their telling me about it. We may have even more business for the union to look into.
Well, we appreciate you being with us today on Stardom.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us on WOW, way back on Wednesday. These are a lot of fun for us to put up, and it seems like you all enjoy them too, based on your comments, so keep them coming. Subscribe, like, and share, and we will see you next week.